Black man, black man, black man. Black man, black man, black man. Black man, black man, black man. Black man, black man, black man.
You want to be black man, out of here, you're welcome to go.
Black man, black man, black man, black man. Black man, black man, black man. Black man.
In the greetings of peace in paradise, assalamu alaikum. Rahmatullah barakatuh, that's peace in paradise. Greetings of peace in paradise. Assalamu alaikum. Thank you again for joining us this Sunday morning, the last weekend of January. The last time I was on, we're in the 313 area. We were addressing issues. It's actually embracing these sacrifices of Dr. Martin Luther King. It was the 15th of January, and how Dr. King had met with my grandfather, the Most Honorable Elijah Muhammad, shortly before we lost Dr. King. That was an address that I was very proud to be able to make, because I am a portrait artist originally by trade, and I had made a portrait of Dr. King. And we're sharing one of the comments Dr. King made during his Washington address of the people, those people of color have been given a check of insufficient funds. My grandfather, Most Honorable Elijah Muhammad, I wrote a book which I've been featuring quite often here on the program. This book was published and made available in November of 2002. So in 2002, that was shortly after the country changed dramatically, you know, after 9/11, and what the country had suffered due to 9/11. So many people in this country began to read copies of the Holy Quran. Yeah, the Honorable Elijah Muhammad, as you notice, that Fez is full of diamonds. The Honorable Elijah Muhammad, he taught that we should invest in self-reliance. You know, today, so many of our businesses have fallen to the wayside, you know, after the dollar stores, Dollar Trees have put so many black businesses out of contention. We can't compete with those kinds of prices. The in Detroit, the city where Master Farhad Muhammad came in 1930, and that was right after the Depression, the Great Depression is oftentimes referred to. The Great Depression saw an economic level of devastation that is hard to imagine. My grandfather, the Honorable Elijah Muhammad, he in this book, it talks about how the plight of my family, you know, during the Great Depression, you know, when the auto industry was devastated. My grandfather, his father was a Baptist minister. My grandfather taught himself how to read out of the Bible. And my great-grandfather left the South in 1923 to come to, and my grandfather's oldest brother, Sam, came to get jobs here in the industrial North. But by 1930, when Master Farad Muhammad came to the house, my grandmother was shared with me how she was sitting on the back porch, and one of her girlfriends came up along the fence, and she had with her Master Farad Muhammad was accompanying her. He was known to be the son of a cloth merchant. He approached the house. They were living in a shotgun house. That's the way my grandmother described it. Sister Clara Muhammad. you know, she said Master Farad Muhammad asked her where was brother. Speaking of her husband, you know, she said he's laying across the bed as drunk as a coot. You know, that was the condition Master Farad Muhammad found my family in here in Detroit. My father was born in 1929. She had four children. She had Emmanuel, Ethel, Lottie, Nathaniel, and Herbert. So she had five children, and she eventually gave my grandfather eight. So you know, her children were playing. My father was only a silly arm baby, born in 1929. You know, we are faced with many adversities today. We call it economic adversities. But my grandmother says she was so depressed until she felt like turning on the gas and putting her head in the oven. I mean, it's hard for us to fathom that type of depression. You know, today one of the principal death rates in this country has to do with suicide. You know, between the gun violence and the suicide, you know, it speaks of. They say, "Behold, I shall send unto you Elijah." That's the last chapter of the Old Testament. "Behold, I shall send unto you Elijah, who will turn the hearts of the fathers to the children and the children to the fathers, lest I come and smite the earth with a curse." You know, it's the great and dreadful day of the Lord. We live in a great day in terms of technology, but yet at the same time we are faced with such ugliness. You know, last week I didn't come down and go on the air. We had mass shootings in California. The Asian community. They say the Asian community generally a community that don't believe in having guns, but as of the last 10 or 20 years, the Asian community have begun to embrace firearms. But the readiness, availability of firearms, they say is really quite problematic in this country. Second Amendment in dealing with firearms, this is a major issue in this country, you know. About a month ago, we had a visit from the head of the FBI came here through Detroit, and he was speaking of how the internet radicalizes, you know, these young people. They become lone wolf assassins. They, you know, this is a very problematic situation here in this country. You know, the Second Amendment giving us the right to bear arms. Some might view that as being the right to kill. You know, if I have the right to bear arms, and this is the land of the free and home of the brave, so that means, you know, I mean, it's deplorable. I mean, the man who, the Asian who murdered seven people, he went to the parking lot of the police station and turned himself in. These kinds of behaviors are horrible, you know. In Arizona, they go into a school and just, you know, begin to just murder the little children. America is in a very, very deep moral crisis, and we have to really take this very, very seriously, you know. And we just had a situation in Memphis, Tennessee, where it's four black officers, you know, it was almost like a Rodney King beat down of a murder of a young man struck down at 22 years old. We had the Black Lives Matter marches, you know, through the streets, you know, but on the internet it speaks, you know, I mean, they say Black Lives Matter, but Black Lives Matter to who? Okay, a statistic placed on the internet saying that when it comes to black on black crime in the inner cities, they say between 1984 and 2019, they say black people killed more than 324,000 of our own people. I mean, this is such a deplorable statement. You know, we have to really wade into this and understand. You know, matter of fact, in this book came out, I said, in 2002. You know, I speak about how, you know, one of the statistics I offer is if you're born a black male in America, it's a 50% chance you won't make your 25th birthday. You know, this is a horrible statistic, you know, because 9 out of 10 times it's going to be another black person to kill you. That's a horrible statistic, very horrible statistic. You know, see what it speaks to is the. We are a subculture, you know. It speaks to the lack of value that is placed on that we place on our own lives and therefore place on the lives of other people. This is horrible. It's a horrible statistic. You know, even when it comes to abortion, I know there's a big outcry in this country. Even in the state of Michigan, they have voted to repeal Roe versus Wade. But why did the Supreme Court strike down, Roe versus Wade after 50 years of allowing, mothers to abort their children? We live in an age of contraception. There's, and where is moral restraint? Statistically, it is stated that black women abort their children three times more than Caucasian women. So, mentioned in the last airing of the program, I spoke about how, we were taught, by the statistics given to us, is that globally, people of color, if you want to use, that word, we are the original people of the planet, is where we prefer to refer that to that, is they outnumber Caucasians 11 to 1. So if they outnumber Caucasians 11 to 1, then self-preservation is the law, first law of nature. So if they, my grandfather taught separatism because, the perception of interracial marriage when it comes to the dominant class in this country, which is Caucasian, the laws of this country originally addressed Caucasian males. The female population did not have the right to vote, no more than black people had the right to vote. Okay, black people referred to as two-thirds of a human being. And this N-word that we were taught, this has to do with their feeling as though they actually created a people in us, okay? See, the dominant society, Caucasian society, view interracial marriage as a form of genocide against them because the babies born out of interracial marriage they're not going to be Caucasian. If they're already outnumbered 11 to 1, America was settled, considered a safe haven for the Caucasian race. This is the law. This is how the law was set up, The Nina, the Pina, the Santa Maria, those were Spanish ships. We spoke about that in an earlier program. The what impelled compelled Caucasians to come across that ocean, to settle in this part of the world in the first place. The Moors went into Spain and dominated Spain for about 810 years. There's a couple of figures that kind of maybe 700 something, 90 something, depends on, you can Google it. And they had a tax they put on the Moors, African nation, galvanized under Islam, the spread of Islam in that part of the world. So they were hundreds of millions of Africans, okay, and these Spanish Europeans and other Europeans were fleeing from the domination of the black people, because the Moors put a tax on the Spanish of 100 of their fairest maidens from every province. And they had a lot of provinces, you know, and they wanted their fairest maidens. So the navigator, even on the ship for Christopher Columbus, was a Moor, okay? So they were fleeing. It's common, the gingerification of America, the browning of America. You know, so white flight is not just a local, national, but it's an international address, okay, when it comes to Caucasian race, okay? And so my grandfather, the mantra was that we believe in separation. My grandfather said, we live in another man's house, okay? And respect breeds respect, you know? So if you want respect, you have to give respect. This was in the lack of respect, you know, that we have for one another and for others. This is a very serious issue. And behold, I shall send unto you Elijah, who will turn the hearts of the fathers to the children, the children to the fathers. Today, you know, with the advent in the last 30 years of the internet, and our young people, they have these cell phones in their hands like crazy glue, you know, when it comes to their constantly deferring to Google or to Wikipedia. We don't go to our parents. We don't go to our seniors. And this creates a divide, in rather than a bond between our elders and our and young people. They call a lost generation. These are very serious cultural issues. You know, I mean, we have to think about these things. You know, in terms of the cultural impact. I mean, intimacy between men and women, our brothers and sisters. The intimacy has. I mean, we have Viagra, you know. I mean, intimacy has become almost a sport. I mean, the sisters, you know, they bear the brunt of this in many cases. But yet at the same time, the laws therefore often favor the sister because she bears the brunt. But see, the power been given, like out in the harbor of New York, there's a Statue of Liberty, a woman holding up a torch. Now that statue was given to America in 1863 by the French. You know, the power given to our female population in Africa, a woman can't take your babies. You hire someone to raise your children, a nanny, okay? But a woman can't take your babies. So it appears as though even with the Supreme Court recognizing this overreach when it comes to the power of be given to the females. I mean, the casualness of intimacy. You know, it's a tragic situation. Okay, if you can be stripped of your driving privileges, you can be put in jail for not taking care of these children, that you become casually involved in with sex and intimacy. It's deplorable. It's deplorable. Moral decay, you know, is indicative of all forms of a meltdown of a people. Okay, I ran into a young lady here in Detroit, she said that her mother taught her that if she become pregnant and the guy doesn't do what she tell him to do, she will abort his child. You know, such an ugly address from a mother who will use her child as a bargaining chip. Okay, even when it comes to this book, I talk about how there's a whole group of females who address welfare brides. They, you know, see the vows of marriage for a man are not the same vows as they are for a woman. The vows of a man, he is her provider. You know, this should be the focus of our young black men seeking to be able to be in a position as being a provider. But the irony of this is that three times as many black women are graduating college as black men. This is a serious problem, you know, in our society, you know, which needs serious reform. Okay, when it comes to, you know, because a female biologically, okay, she is not the same. As a man, females bear children, men give children, but you have to also understand that when you go out to the produce market and you see that large variety of produce, what makes the difference in an apple, a plum, a watermelon, or a grapefruit? It's the seed. You cannot discount the seed or the sperm, and men are oftentimes treated as sperm donors, stripped of in terms of their cavalier. You know, listen, in the Arab people, see, Detroit is one of the largest concentration of Arab-speaking people in this country. There are people. If you listen to the music, the culture of the music, you know, I will do wrong for you, honey. Okay, I mean, it's a we could not possibly believe in God. We believe in each other. Okay, you know, we don't, you know. God is the one who based on the DNA in the womb. Okay, the embryo takes on the form of the human being. Okay, so we must treasure and honor the evolutional nature of creation, okay, and this is fundamental, okay. So, you know, in Genesis says, you know, the Spirit of God moved upon the face of the deep. When you say the Spirit of God moved upon the face of the deep and said, you know, let there be light. This is opening verses of the Bible. In the Holy Quran, much of what's in the Holy Quran is almost word for word in the Bible. So you know, this when they say the Spirit of God, the name Allah refers to 99 of the Creator's attributes. When they say the Spirit of God, they're talking about the attributes of God. You know, the Great Bang. Well, the Great, but that was intellectual thought, okay, that moved upon the face of the deep. We have to understand these things. The human brain, okay, it's made out of pure protein, and the neural receptors. It's a water droplet-like substance comes down one of the nerve endings and it dissipates into a bright flash of light. Now, this goes on 10,000 places in the brain, but this is just like there are the stars that are in the heavens. As Christ, he said, you know, the earth is my footstool and the heavens is my kingdom. You know, the human brain, just like the just like the stars in the heavens, you know, when that bright flash of light when it comes, you know, down that nerve and then dissipating into a bright flash of light, they say so bright until it would blind you to see. So if that's going on at 10,000 places in the brain, you know, if a quarter of them flash at one time, that's 250,000. That's Einstein said E equaled MC squared. So that's inverted light. So we have to understand the preciousness of life. This is the point. This is where I'm going with this conversation, or this discourse, is we have to understand the preciousness of life, you know, and wade into that, okay, the name Jesus, you know, as you notice, I've carried this name, of the Messiah. I've carried this name for the past 50 years. I adopted this name. I was originally named after my father, but the name Jesus is a Greek name. Okay, it says in the Bible, tells us that the Christ, he spoke Aramaic and Hebrew, okay. In Hebrew, Jesus means helper of Jehovah, Yeshua, helper of Jehovah. The name Elijah means Jehovah is God. In we have to understand something too, and this is quite prophetic, very profound in terms of, you know, our getting a clear understanding. You know, biblically, the Hebrews who are referenced in the Old Testament, and often and perhaps once or twice in the New Testament, the Hebrews, there is nothing in the Bible that tells you anything about color in terms of there being, all of this white supremacy stuff. The Bible does not tell you that the Hebrews were Caucasian. No, matter of fact, even when it mentions King Solomon, they say he had skin like burnt brass. Burnt brass doesn't sound like it's Caucasian to me. Okay, so you know all of this business about in the Most Honorable Elijah Muhammad in the 30s with the teachings of Master Farah Muhammad taught us, you know, he referred to blonde-haired, blue-eyed devils. You know, why would such a reference be given in identifying, because these people are in a mode of self-defense. You know, in the Southern Baptist scripture, you know, it refers to black people as being devils. So if you are taught to hate your own self, you know, so whoever teaches a person to help hate their own self, hate your own black features, you know, whoever will teach you that person that teach you to hate your own self, he cannot be anything but a devil. Okay, this is the root. This is the rudimentary point made when this by such an address. You know, even that swastika. That swastika was first seen in Japan in 3400. You know, the teachings of Zen is that say that if your enemy uses a weapon on you, what you do, you just don't forge another weapon, just turn it around on them. That's what that's all about. Okay, you know, and my grandfather said, we cannot turn around and mistreat them. Because that's how they got themselves in trouble with God, by mistreating us. I mean, the Europeans that settled in this part of the world, you know, Abraham Lincoln, George Washington, these men had a slew of black women concubines. And strapping our grandmothers over a bedpost and taking them like a horse in a stall. The British never did that. The British went into India, went into parts of Africa, went into parts of they call Great Britain. They were the masters of the seas. You know, America established under President Eisenhower, the 6th and the 7th Fleet, modeled after Great Britain. But Britain, they're the ones that outlawed slavery. You know, they say, well, slavery goes back way, way far back in history. You know, not the kind of slavery that was implemented by the Europeans who settled in this part of the world. They invented a whole brand new form of slavery, you know, bastardizing a people. That's where that N-word comes from. They bastardized our people, you know, stripped them of our culture, our language. You know, that's why they say 3/5 of the human being, because once you're stripped of your culture and your language, you know, then you're reduced to chattel animal state. Even with Oprah Winfrey, she made a movie, The Color Purple, where a man would have put himself on his daughter. Okay, he was a product of 15 generations of chattel. Okay, moral decay. What we have to understand. I mean, Eli Whitney, who invented the cotton gin, and he was a black man, and his slave master was an engineer, and when the when the Southerners produced enough cotton, and cotton became king, you know, from swapping cotton all over the world for gold, when they got when they received enough gold, then they decided to print their own money. That's what caused the Civil War. But it was the intellectual properties of that black man who invented that cotton gin that brought cotton to become king for them to swap all that gold and swap it for gold. So one of the biggest wars in this country was a Civil War. And what is in play today is the divisions between race. And we have to come to a reckoning, like even the when it comes to separation in this country. If you want respect, you have to give respect, okay? And this means that we should understand that interracial marriage is a form of biological warfare against Caucasian people, okay? And that's the long and the short of it, okay? And they say there's an elephant in the room. That's a psychological profiling. You say, well, what is the elephant in the room? The elephant is racism. Today we have our president Biden. He is the second Catholic president America ever put in office, and he speaks about systemic racism. Bernie Sanders, who is an open socialist, okay, who is over President Biden's economic program. Even under President Obama, when they did the Washington sit out, you know, speaks about how 10% of the 1% control 99% of the wealth in this country. 10% of the 1% control 99% of the wealth in this country. This is pathetic, okay? This is totally pathetic, okay? I mean, this could not have happened unless it was a system in play that made this. But just because they tell you, and they'll be open to tell you what the situation is, does that bring address to the problem? Can you change the problem? How did it get so far out of whack? 10% of the 1% control 99% of the money. Okay, that could not happen unless there was a very serious system in play. Okay, and I say we are a subculture. Okay, the Arabs, they dropped those towers up in New York. You know, God have mercy on them people. You know, I mean, 2,500 people, 3,000, more than 3,000 people. Yeah, but hundreds of firemen going up there trying to save those people. You know, 15 out of 19 were Saudi nationals. The Saudis put an ocean of oil at America's disposal at the dawn of the Industrial Revolution, selling the oil for $2.25 a barrel between 1930 and 1973, before they decided to establish the cartel. You know, many used to be commercials in the 60s say America's heartbeat on oil. Today, everything is going electric, okay, the automobile. I mean, so fossil fuels and exploitation of fossil fuels is becoming a serious crisis. They say that even Bill Gates' foundation, did a study when they say we will overcome this pandemic. But they say one of the greatest crises that face humanity today is global warming. We have billions of dollars being spent trying to address global warming. When I was in college in 67, you know, I went to, they spoke of how if the polar caps were to melt, that the ocean water would come to the shoulders of the Statue of Liberty. So this is not something that they were not aware of when it came. This is also, see, it was Rockefeller who went to the Saudis and brokered the deal with the Saudis, Standard Oil of New Jersey, offered them, $7 million in gold, non-refundable, to just excavate for the oil because they had already found the oil in Kuwait. But, you know, but it was the Rockefeller, the same guy, he was the one who established the Fermi Lab there in Chicago. I was raised in Chicago. You know, I'll go over and debate these people over at the Fermi Lab. As a matter of fact, I have done extensive study in the area of nuclear physics. You know, in this most recent book, I came out with the Evolution of the Nation of Islam, second edition. In this book, I speak about how, you can take a six-inch magnifying glass, and you can bounce that magnifying glass off of a diamond and create a lightning bolt. See, let me say, to capture the full image of the solar disk, you need a six-inch magnifying glass. You can start a fire with a small magnifying glass, but if you take a six-inch magnifying glass, you can bounce it off of a diamond. A diamond is an indefinitely large single molecule. Now, it's the force of the reflection off the, just like the reflection off the water is what puts the horizon above us. You know, in the Holy Quran, there's a chapter called El Nur, which means the light. If you look at the stars on a clear night, light travels in 360 degrees. It's thrown out in 360 degrees. But when you look straight at a star, you only see the light that's coming straight toward you. You can't see the light that goes out into 360 degrees. Light is not visible. Okay, only thing we see is the reflection of the light that bounces off of something. So that's why I say you take a diamond and you bounce the reflection of a six-inch magnifying glass. You know, the impact of the reflection on the molecules of the atmosphere is what creates the lightning, a lightning bolt. And you triangulate that light, just like there's a triangulation of light between the Earth, Sun, and Moon. The Master Muhammad told us, unlike attract, like repel, so you triangulate the light. So, you know, just like the atom itself, it's three particles. So that's a triangulation. But oftentimes some people want to go to the word Trinity, but the word Trinity is not even in the Bible. Okay, I challenge any members of the clergy, you know, to go and find the word Trinity in the Bible. It's not there. Okay, my grandfather, you know, Master Farah Muhammad, given us a knowledge of the speed of light, the speed of sound, the speed of the earth rotation, things like this, a true knowledge of God, okay, you know, this is what was lacking, okay, but it was my grandfather's background. I mean, the word, my grandfather gave a lot of Arabic names. Minister Farrakhan, his name. But the Honorable Elijah Muhammad, He never changed his name. His name is, in Elijah means Jehovah is God. Muhammad is the name that was given to the revelator, one to whom the Quran was revealed more than 1,400 years ago. His name was Ahmed. Ahmed was given, and Ahmed means the trustworthy. Okay, Muhammad is a title. It means praised and praiseworthy. That's a title. Okay, his first name means Elijah. Okay, Jehovah is God. Jesus means helper of Jehovah. In Arabic, the name Jesus is pronounced as we know, we're taught biblically that in the, that Christ spoke Aramaic and Hebrew in Arabic. It's pronounced Isa. Isa means the swifter spirit of one who can think fast, and they say you can't think fast lest it be by God's permission. Okay, in the Catholic Church, it says the race is given to the swift. This is intimated an understanding of Christ's name, Isa. The swifter spirit, one who can think fast. You know, he said the Holy Quran teaches us that man's head was crowned with hikmah, knowledge. Okay, my grandfather said, told us that wisdom, knowledge, and understanding. Wisdom, knowledge, and understanding. Wisdom is one thing. Knowledge is another thing. And understanding is another thing. In the Psalms, it says, seek, teaches us, King Solomon teaches us, seek knowledge, but by all means get an understanding. Seek knowledge, but by all means get an understanding. In understanding, the word W-O-R-D, word. The Holy Quran tells us Allah is the giver of the word. Master Farad Muhammad spoke 16 different languages and several dialects. He gave us the word, the understanding of a true understanding of God. Okay, and it's whose proper name is pronounced Allah. This, you know, referring to the 99 attributes of the Creator. So seek knowledge, but by all means, get an understanding. You know, understanding gives you the ability to wield the sword of knowledge. So this biological warfare. You know, my grandfather said, we were like Samson, placed in between the two pillars of the great idol. On one side is this man's woman, and the other side is this man's money. Okay, so he said, we live in another man's house. So if we, you know, anytime there's such a shameful statistic, and they have verifiable, that we didn't kill 324,000 of our own people between 1984 and 1919. They want to wash our face with those kind of statistics. How can they say, if you don't respect life, how could you possibly say you believe in God? Okay, how can you possibly say you believe in God and you don't respect life? You know, life, you know, this is the dilemma that we have been faced with today. And this is something we have to address very seriously. Okay, an understanding of what life is, what the true and living God. Christ said that the earth is my footstool and the heavens is my kingdom. You know, it's not like the Mormons talking about God visited the earth and then he went to some other planet. You know, Christ and is spoken of, he will return. He didn't say, you know, he, you know, and we are the witnesses, the Jehovah Witnesses. They say that we live in a messianic age. You know, the Quran tells us Allah is the knower of the unseen. You can't see what's pushing that car down the street, but there's a, you know, the Quran teaches us that there are three, there's men, jinn, and angels. The jinn is created from fire, okay? Underneath the hood of that car, there's an engine, okay? 2200 degrees, it's the, see, Lucifer was created from fire. The, you know, referred to in the Holy Quran as Iblis. He was created, that's the reason why, out in the middle of the harbor of New York, a woman holding up that torch. You have the largest concentration of Arab-speaking people here in Detroit, where it's considered to be the enslavement of the jinn class. See, Lucifer said, when God placed man above Lucifer, Lucifer vowed to bring man down. Okay, Lucifer said, you know, how many things were created from fire? Okay, but man has today, he has mastered fire and made fire, you know, one of the principal tools of just like when God created all things, he created from fire. So I'm not going to go to, I would advise you to please review these programs and because I'm confined to a very short period of time to spend with you addressing these very critical issues, you know, even they say firearms, okay? Gunpowder was brought from China by Marco Polo, okay? I mean, when the Europeans saw that gunpowder, he had a whole different idea about what to do with that gunpowder. He could not have killed the 87 million Indians, 200 million buffalo. With that, I'm going to give you the greetings of peace and paradise, as I did in my opening, and look forward to speaking with you again. And please, by all means, love yourself. One of the biggest statistics in this country is suicide. You know, and the ready availability of firearms. You know, again, I greet you the greetings of peace and paradise of Assalamu Alaikum, and look forward to speaking with you again. Thank you so much for your time, and look forward to our next meeting here in the 313 area. And we're so thankful for Brother Watkins and his allowing us this opportunity.
Black man, black man, black man, woof. 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 Black man, black man, woof. Black man, 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 black man, black man, woof.